Hello, everyone, and welcome to today's University and Jepson Herbaria mini workshop series, which is all about lichens, specifically a big world in a small package, lichen biology, identification, and conservation. My name is Clara Scharnagel, and I will be your guide on this journey today, learning all about lichens. So, just briefly, our agenda for today. We'll start with the very basic question of what is a lichen, and then get into what is a lichen species, followed by a break. Then we'll really dig into some lichen terms and traits, which will help us to get to know lichens better and also on our journey of trying to identify different lichens, followed by another break, because that's going to be a lot all at once. Then I will introduce you to some local lichens and ask the question of what are lichens up to? What are they doing in the environment? What are they doing all around us right now? Another short break, and then we'll come back and ask what can we learn from lichens? And I will share with you some of my favorite lichen resources. And then finally, right at the end, we will wrap up with just what have we covered today? And then also a little journey around the world with lichens. So our first module, module one, is what is a lichen? So when I first think about the question, what is a lichen? I start with the basics, which is if you go outside and you look at trees or rocks or even the sidewalk, all of those colorful splotches that you might just assume are part of the trees or rocks or sidewalks are in fact lichens. They are alive. They are their own thing, separate from the trees and rocks and sidewalks and soil. And they are in fact quite complex. But let's start with the colorful splotches. So, as you can see in these photographs here, these are different rocks in California. We have quite a few different colorful splotches on these rocks, and each of those different colors, of course, is a different lichen. I really enjoy gathering quotes of the different ways that people have described lichens throughout time. Dan Jansen is a very well-known tropical ecologist, and in one of his books on tropical ecology, he describes lichens like this. Ecologically, lichens are hardly more than intricate scum on rock and tree surfaces that are too harsh for angiosperms. And while I feel like the term scum is a little degrading, I love this quote because, in a way, he's absolutely right. Lichens are found where conditions are too harsh for many other things to exist. And if you think about it, they are kind of like intricate scum. There's a whole bunch of components involved, and they're hard to classify in any other way. But let's try. So, seriously, what is a lichen? The classic definition of a lichen is a symbiotic association between a filamentous fungal partner, that's our little friend there saying hello there, and a photosynthetic partner. This is usually green algae, but it can sometimes be cyanobacteria instead. Or, of course, lichens being lichens, it can be green algae and cyanobacteria. So this is the classic definition, this partnership between two totally different species coming together to form what we recognize as a lichen. As I mentioned, sometimes there's either a cyanobacteria instead of an algae, or as I'm illustrating here, a cyanobacteria in addition to an algae. And that's what we're seeing in this example of Peltigera aftosa, one of our pelt lichens that grows right on the ground. It is this beautiful leafy green lichen, but then you see these dark splotches on it, and those dark splotches are actually these unique structures called cephalodia, which house the cyanobacteria. So the question arises, of course, why have both algae and cyanobacteria? But let's backtrack. why form a symbiosis with an algae if you're a filamentous fungus? What's the dealio? The dealio is that these fungi provide this structure, provide a house, essentially, and the algae are inside of it. And the fungi really structure themselves to optimize the photosynthesis for the algae. And in so doing, the algae in return gives some of the products of photosynthesis, so carbohydrates, sugars, to the fungus. And so that's the exchange that's going on. The fungus is providing a structure, it's providing water and nutrients and things like that. And in exchange, the algae through photosynthesis is providing sugars, which feed the fungus. That's the symbiosis. What does the cyanobacterial partner do? Well, on its own, it does photosynthesis, but many cyanobacterial species, particularly those found in lichens, also fix atmospheric nitrogen, which can be a very limiting resource. And so it's actually really advantageous to be a lichen that associates with both green algae and cyanobacteria in these isolated compartments, because the conditions required for photosynthesis are very different from the conditions required for nitrogen fixation. And so this particular lichen, Peltidra aftosa, has really optimized its conditions to have the sugars from the photosynthesis of the green algae across the entire thing, and then these specialized compartments where the cyanobacteria can focus on fixing nitrogen. Boom. It gets more complex. Just when we thought we totally understood the lichen symbiosis and like, okay, it's a one-to-one partnership, but sometimes there's this additional partner or alternative partner. Oh, whoops, there's more. So what we get to here is this really interesting study which put lichens on the map. So this was the cover story of Science in 2016. And it was this discovery of this potential additional partner in lichen symbiosis. These are Basidiomycete yeasts. So they're different from the fungus that forms the main structure of the lichen. And in fact, they're found in sort of just within or just below that outer layer of the lichen. And we're not yet fully sure what their role is, but we do believe that they play some role in some of the specialized metabolite production in lichens, which is a really big part of what's involved in the lichen symbiosis and being a lichen. But they may also play a role in actually the structuring of the lichen. But research is ongoing with this, and they haven't been found universally across all lichens, mostly in these more three-dimensional leafy or bushy kinds of lichens, which we'll get into in more detail in the next modules. So the truth of the matter is there are many different ways to describe lichens, and we're still figuring out the best way to do so. Lichens are symbioses, but they're also communities. In fact, they're whole ecosystems. As I'm continuing in this little cartoon of my lichen community, lichens, of course, also have their own bacterial microbiome, and they even have a fungal mycobiome, a fungi that may just be living in or on the lichen, but not directly involved in the symbiosis. And so I feel like the best term to describe these is a term holobiont. So this, the credit of coinage of this term has been given to multiple people, but I know it from Lynn Margulies. And holobiont is defined as an assemblage of a host species and the many other species living in, on, or around it that together form a discrete ecological unit. And that discrete ecological unit is what you and I recognize as a lichen. And to sort of bring in another quote that I really love about lichens, but really sums up what I just went through here in this first module, which is, let's try to define a lichen. Oh, whoops, it's actually really complicated. Well, okay, let's give them this term that works, but then there's a lot of stuff that we have to be thinking about as we're thinking of this term. So lichens are the overlooked organisms that keep challenging our assumptions about life. What is a lichen? Is it an individual? Is it a single species? No, it is many things. It is a holobiont. So in our next module, we'll get into what is a lichen species, because after all that, how on earth do we give names to these things? You will find out. And for now, I will happily take any questions.